animation, templates, Java, CSS, Python. Isn't that all too much? Website making sounds like a challenge. Well, no stress, cause I've got you a one-stop solution for this. Wix Studios is a robust and all-round tool that helps you build a dynamic website with or without code. It's entirely up to you. It's an intuitive and efficient platform, which is also designer-friendly. No need to pay a hefty amount of money to developers with the struggle of limited resources and pre-made template generators. Your hassle stops here. And no, I'm not talking about basic functional websites alone. I'm talking about fully functional websites with all the bells and whistles that you can think of. I'm not kidding, because today in this video, I'm going to teach you how to build this website with parallax scroll. Let's see how. So here's the design that I made on Figma. Now, it's a basic website. Now, of course, this is not how a typical e-commerce website looks like, because you understand that this is one product in one page. So that's not ideal. But for the sake of this, since I'm teaching you something, I think this just works. This is something that I quickly made on Figma. You know, it has, a normal header at the top with search and stuff like that. And then it has the name, or one part of the name, written behind, with a huge floating image of the cutout of the sneaker. And on the right side, you have, you know, the name of the series, which is Nocta in this case, followed by the name of the sneaker, some description, the price, color, and the button to buy it. Do you want this Figma file for free? If yes, let me know in the comments. If there are enough comments, I'm going to share this on Figma community for free. All right, let's get started. So here we have the design. First and foremost, you need to install this plugin called Figma to Wix Studio. I have it already installed. It's very simple. Just search for it from Figma itself. And then when you see it, just add it to your Figma and then you're good to go. What this does essentially is it converts your Figma designs into CSS and HTML, and it transports it so that, you know, you can do the other stuff on top of it. So it just takes care of the basic website building in just one click. So that's what essentially the plugin does. And we are going to use it today. And if you'll see, it actually teaches you everything in the process, what you need to do out here. All right, so first and foremost, let us also quickly get started with Wix Studio. So just go to wix.com/studio, create a free account with your Google ID, and you are good to go. After you've logged in, you will probably see a view like this, which is like the back end of Wix Studio. If you go to the sites tab on the left panel out here, you will see all the sites or the websites that you have built. Now, I have already built one because I've shown you the preview. Today, I'm going to recreate the same thing to show it to you. So this is the one which I have made, is shown up out here. If you're new here, you'd probably see something empty without any sites out there. So first and foremost, let's go ahead and create a new site. So when you click on this, it has a couple of options. You can pick from some of the templates as well. But since we have our own design, we are designers after all, we will start from Studio Blank Canvas. So when you click on this, Wix Studio loads up with a blank template. So there we have a blank template. This is how the tool works. It's working in a browser, by the way. You know, this is our browser, so I've hidden the tabs thing. It looks seamless, but it's actually a browser where you're working on. And here you have all the different things that you need for doing. It's like the layers, just like you have on Figma or any other design tool, you know, followed by pages, because a website can have multiple pages, as in when you click, ours is going to be a single page where you just have, you know, four or five sneakers one after another, but you may have multiple pages, you know, followed by the sections, the styles. We will get to styles very soon. Media, everything, essentially anything that you need for designing this website. Okay, so I'll just go ahead and close it. And here you will see there are three sections which are already added. Sections are nothing but groups, frames, or even auto layouts that you see on Figma. So when I click on these layers, you will see these are nothing but, think of them like auto layout. This entire page is one auto layout, which has three other auto layouts inside, which is header, section, and footer. And on the right hand side, you have the controls, which we'll get in a bit. But for now, you know, don't worry about any of these and just go ahead and delete all of them, because, you know, we want an absolutely blank slate, because we are going to import things from Figma that we have already designed. Now, this is actually the empty state, which says choose your starting point. You can, you know, do a bunch of things out here. So we have our blank file ready. Now we will go back to Figma. So when we go back to Figma, of course, I made four different screens for it. It's essentially going to be one long page, but for the sake of transporting it, only one of them is enough. So we are going to use the first one, right? Because it's just a structure that goes there. Then you copy paste five times, and then you just change the content and you're done, because you create the effects only once and it just gets repeated to every section, because that's how code works, right? And in this process, I promise you, I'm not going to write a single line of code. All right, so we will select this frame and just click on this thing out here, which says plugins, and click on Figma to Wix Studio plugin. And this is going to load up the plugin. There you see. Now it says that I'll have to set up for export. There's a one-time thing that I'll have to do for every file that I connect. So let's click on Setup Export. Now it says that I need to copy the Figma URL and inside Wix Studio, paste it inside Tools Import Figma. Okay, and then I have an option. Once I'm done, I'll just click on next and go to the next step. So let's quickly go ahead and copy the link of this file. Then it says go to inside Wix Studio, go to Tools and Import from Figma. Let's go to Wix Studio. This is Wix Studio. So just click on the logo out here. When you hover, it just becomes hamburger. When you click on this one, Tools, you'll see Import from Figma. Now, the moment I click on this, you'll see it immediately creates a new tab. This last thing, Import from Figma, got added the moment I clicked on that Tools Import from Figma. So here's where I paste the link of the Figma file. I'll just do a Command V and click Connect. It will take a few seconds to connect to the Figma file, and it's done. And it's done. It also started showing the preview of what I had selected out there. Now I can actually click on Add to Site and directly add it to this website, but I'm not going to do that because there are a few more things that are remaining which we will do, right? Actually, I will just not do anything out here. Go back to Figma. Okay, so remember this plugin thing was open. So we'll say, okay, I'm done connecting my file because that was successfully done. I'll click on next. And then it says match editing size to frame width. See, what this plugin essentially is doing is it is teaching you how to connect this plugin so that you can seamlessly handshake between them. So I'm just essentially reading out what this is telling me because it's actually very straightforward, right? Okay, so it says match editing size to frame width, which means whatever your frame size on Figma is, you should go that and update that size on Wix Studio also. So this is your project. So inside this, the width of the project is 1280. And actually, since I knew it, since I'd done it in the past, I created my design in 1280 already because that's a default value. Doesn't matter. You can create it 1400, 1300, anything at all. But make sure that whenever you are exporting it, the sizes of the artboards match. It'll be less headache for you essentially, right? So just make sure they are matching. In my case, it is already matching. So I'll just go ahead and click Start Export. Now, when I do that, it shows me three options and it says export styles is the recommended first step. Let's go ahead and do that, right? Styles are nothing but the font sizes, the colors, essentially all of them, the styles that you, perhaps save. In Figma, you have an option of saving those colors and giving it your name, like the way it happens in design systems and all. Kind of a hygiene process. Yeah, so let's go ahead and do it regardless, right? You'll also understand how exporting works. I'll click on export styles and it just picked up all the styles, the colors. There are, you know, 5-6 different kinds of colors that I have used. I've used fonts like Bebas Noi and Google Sans. That's it, right? It picked up everything and I'm just going to click export styles. And it says it's done. It was like instant. It says go to Wix Studio to import the style. So I've exported from here. Now I'll have to import from there, right? So I go to Wix Studio. And it still shows that artboard out here. So every time you do an export from Figma, hit refresh import. So what is getting exported is getting imported as you see out here. There you see all the color styles and textiles which were exported from Figma are now on my Wix Studio. So I'm just going to do apply styles to site here at the bottom. Apply styles to site. I'll just click it. And it is added. So it just updated. I'd shown you this tab before, site styles. It just updated those textiles and color styles with the ones which we just made on Figma. So we are sorted out here. The next step, we are again back here. This time we are going to export this entire frame itself, right? That's all we will export essentially. Okay, so this time I will click on this and I'll just hit back on the plugin so that I see this. So I'll select this one, this home thing that you see out there, and I will click export frame. So I click on export frame. Okay, it's showing me a preview of that. I'll click on this export frame button once again. It says same thing, go to Wix Studio to import. So I'm back here in Wix Studio and I will hit this refresh import button once again. It should load up soon. There we have that same page that is loaded from Figma. Now I can directly go ahead and add it to site. But there's one small thing that we'll have to be mindful about. So when you add it as a frame, you have a couple of options. You can add it as a new page, you can add it as a section or a container. So by default, it will be selected as page. Don't select page, because if you do, it is going to create a new page beyond home and then add it out there, right? Now, if you have designed the entire thing in one frame where your entire website is like entire page is present, sure, go ahead and do that. But in my case, I kind of split up the different sections. I have a reason why I have done it. You will get to know in a bit. So this is just a section, not the entire page. So I'm going to pick section and then I will click on add to site. I've clicked on it. It is adding all these things. So you actually get to see what is happening out here. There it is loaded right now. Okay, so these are all here. And whatever you've done inside Figma, it gets carried forward here. For example, if you have used a frame or an auto layout inside, the same thing kind of gets carried forward here with the same constraints that you have added on Figma. So the layout, it's near perfect. You know, the layout is near perfect. And these are all real text, which I can actually go ahead and edit here if I want to, right? And that's how we will do when we make a copy of that. Everything is editable like real text out here because it's just imported from Figma. The only thing that I see out here is the image of the shoe itself. Now, if you go back to Figma, if you see, this was a nice cutout. It's a transparent PNG with a drop shadow underneath, which I've added here on Figma itself. But here, it just feels like it has drawn a box with a white background and then given the shadow. Why? Why? Did it convert to JPEG? Not really. It is still a PNG because you see, you can actually see that text nocta when you move around. It's just that for the shadow, it has happened. Now, why this is happening is it's because how CSS works. So I found this article which says drop shadow, the underrated CSS filter. So there are essentially two things. One is called a box shadow and the other is a drop shadow. So this image itself is self-explanatory. So CSS by default, the default shadow is a box shadow, which just creates a box around whatever element you give and it adds a shadow to the box. But what we need out here is a drop shadow and not a box shadow. So CSS doesn't understand that all that much. And that's why it is doing what it is doing out there. So there are two ways to fix this. I'm going to show you one and not show you the other because I promised you something at the beginning of this video. You can either go to this section, which is called code, and you can go and change that box shadow to drop shadow if you are comfortable. But if you're not, we have a workaround. And the workaround is you go back to Figma. We don't need this, plugin anymore. Just export the images of these sneakers along with the shadow and export them as PNG. So here are these sneakers, which I had just taken out, and I will export them in 2x because, you know, some screens can be denser. So that's why I'll just export all of them and I'll just save them anywhere in the desktop or anywhere because I will just upload them and I'm done with the work, right? First, what I'll do is I'll just go ahead and delete this one because I don't need this. And then I'll click on this, which says media. I'll click on media and here you can pick any image from Wix's own gallery. I want to upload mine. So just go to site files. The site files are nothing but the images which are a part of my design already, right? These are the images which are already present in my design and it automatically added those images because I use that plugin. Now, this is the untitled.png which we have issue with. So I'm going to just upload all these things that I have just exported here. So these five images, I'm just going to drag and drop into this window. So it is uploading all the four files. And after that, we'll be able to pick one and use it out there. There you go. All five of them are here, four of them are here. Okay, four, not five. So I can go ahead and delete this untitled.png because I don't need it. Let me just move it to trash. So I have these four shoes, shoe one, shoe two, shoe three, and shoe four. I'll just click on shoe one and click add to page. Yep, there you see, here I have it. And since it was bigger, I can actually make it slightly bigger like this because in the original design, the image of the sneaker was pretty big. So it was here. And of course, it was also tilted. Now to rotate it, I can go to this section called adjust and then, you know, adjust a couple of other things out here like scale, skew, and I can also rotate them here if I want to, you know, if I want to make it, okay, it is minus. So maybe around minus 20 or something, but I'll not do that because we are going to add some effects which will automatically take care of that slight tilt that we had. Okay. All right. So we are perfect. We are done out here. We have included the image as well. I'll just close this inspector. And there's one thing that I would do before we proceed to the next step. So in the layers panel, you will see this thing is a header and this is the body, right? So I'm going to repeat this body later, but the header, I want to be one single unit because I don't want the header to be repeating, right? So ideally when I make a copy, it should be one sneaker after another sneaker with one central header at the top. So there's a simple way of doing it. I'm just going to create this section, which is nothing but the top that I've added. This section at the bottom is nothing but this default section, which they already have. We can ignore it for now. And this section, I'm just going to duplicate once, okay? And the top one, I'm going to call header. And this one, I'm going to call section one. And you see, they're identical. It is repeating in both of them, right? Now, the reason I did is because in this header, I'm going to delete everything but this one, right? So this one and this, we will just delete them. And so the header remains with only this one. And the reason why it is showing up blank is because the height of this is set to a particular fixed height, and we will fix that right away. So I'll go to Figma and see the height of my header. This was 64 pixels if you see out here. So I'm going to go back to Wix Studio, and this is my header. This entire section is header. I will select it. If you see, the height is set to 768 pixels, which I don't need. I'll make it to 64 and hit enter. And there we are done. So this is my header section with just the nav thing at the top, because I'm going to make it sticky so that it doesn't scroll away when we are scrolling and so on. And the section one, which means I don't need this header inside section one. So inside section one, which is nothing but where the shoe one or the sneaker one is present, I'm going to delete this container, which is the header. There we go. We have it. So I'm just going to collapse all the screen so that you see what is happening. There we have it. And if you want to see a preview of it, just click on this eye here and you can see the preview. Right now there is just a header and one more section. So if I go back to edit side and say I make a copy of this section, section one, I just duplicate it and I name the second one as section two, which is nothing but, you know, copy of this. If I go back to preview, you will see there are two sections right now. This is exactly what we are going to do. We'll make a copy of it after doing all the effects and animations, and then we will change this image, change this text, and we have all the sections ready. So I go back to edit section and I will delete this section two for now because we haven't done our animations yet. So here we are in section one. Now we are going to do the animations. The first and foremost thing in the shoe itself or in the sneaker, I will select this image and then I will open up this inspector. This is the design space. Just like Figma, you have a design tab and a prototype tab. So this one is the design tab and this one is the animation and effects tab. So I'm going to click on animation and effects tab, which is the second one out here. Now, the moment you go there, you would see it is very simply put out, right? If you want an entrance animation, you can add it here. You can click on it and there are so many different things that you can pick from. You hover on one of these effects and it shows you how the entrance would be. But I'm not looking for an entrance animation. What I'm looking for is a scroll animation, because some sort of a parallax effect I want to create, you know, the shoe slightly rotating as it's coming up in the space and so on. So it is being triggered by the scroll of the page. So I'm going to click on scroll. And then I'll click on add. And then when I click on add, there are many effects which are already present out here. You can hover and see whatever you want. What I had chosen for this design was this thing called spin. Spin is nothing but rotate, right? So I'll click on this spin and the animation type is set to in, essentially when it is going inside, right? Don't change it, just the default one is good enough. So click on spin and a spin animation is actually added. It's done. If you want to see a preview, just click on this preview and then scroll. Yeah, I'm scrolling. Of course, it is spinning in a weird way. We will fix that in a bit. But the animation is actually added. You're scrolling and the shoe is spinning or moving or rotating, right? But we will fix it the way we want. So we go back to edit side and there we have it. So if you see on this shoe, a spin animation is added as a scroll, right? So I'll click on the spin. When I do, I can change it to something else, but I don't want to change. But what I want to do is I want to adjust the animation, which is right here at the bottom. So spin is selected and I'll click on adjust animation. And when I click on adjust animation, this thing opens up, right? That I can pick the direction, the spin count, scale, animation area, and a ton of other things, right? Direction, straightforward. I will keep it clockwise. Spin count, That's where we'll get. But before that, the scale is set to 70%. Why? I will just make it 100% because I don't want the thing to get smaller when the animation is happening. 100% scale is good enough for me. Animation area is essentially the area within which the animation will get executed. That's what it means. So here it shows 0 to around 50%. But what I want is slightly more than 50%, okay? And this is something that you can trial and error and do. You can keep adjusting and see. That's what we'll do here. I feel in a little more than around 75% is what I'm looking at. We will see how it works. Okay, now if you go and see a preview, it'll be even more weird if you see what is happening, right? It is weird. 75% of the screen is getting covered with this animation. From 0% to 75% is when the animation is executing. And the last 25%, which is this, no animation is executing. It has already done its job, right? That's what it essentially does. But it is spinning too much. It is spinning too much. So what we can have, the way we can fix it is reduce the amount of spin, which is go to adjust animations once again. Spin count, make it a very small number. I'll make it maybe 0.2 or something. Let's see how it works. Okay, I'll hit 0.2 and then we'll go and see a preview once again. Yeah, you see, now it feels much more subtler. Okay, yeah, I feel it's still a little too much. I want to make it even small, maybe 0.1. Okay, let's make it 0.15. Okay, we'll make it 0.15. I don't know what difference it will make, but let's see it regardless. I'll just go see a preview. And I also feel that, not 75, maybe 80%, because, you know, when it hits here, this is where the animation stops. It doesn't animate anymore because I've set it to 75%. I want it to go a little more, maybe 80 or 90%. Let's try 80% first and then we will do it, right? So that's at 75. I'm going to make it maybe around 80%. Let's see. I'm doing trial and error. Okay, this feels much, much better than before. I can perhaps make it 90 as well, but I will just keep it this way. Yeah, I think this is fine. This looks good. Okay, all right. So let's go back to edit. Now we'll add animations to this background thing that you have out here. Because see, to make a parallax effect stand out, when you have multiple moving things and things which move relative to each other, the effect kind of comes out even much better, right? That's what we'll do. We are moving the shoe, which is in the front. We're also moving the big text, which is at the back, a little bit in the opposite direction. And that's where it will just feel like a lot of 3D stuff is happening. So I'll select this text, which is behind, which is Nocta. And then I will go to the animation tab. And again, add a scroll animation to it. I'll click on add and add a parallax. Okay, so I've added the parallax. And if I further go inside adjust animation, you will see all these options inside. So it is shown a default value. Of course, for the parallax one, the values itself are different. There you had, directional rotation and all. Here you have speed and animation area. So by default, they've given it animation area from 0% all the way up to 100%. That is throughout the duration of your scroll. And speed, it has given 0.5. Now it's tough to understand what 0.5 means until we see a preview. So let's go ahead and click on this preview and then we scroll it. Right now you don't really see what is happening. If you look at Nocta, is it really moving or is it not moving? You don't understand it. The reason being, it is subtly moving. Okay, so 0.5 is actually maybe a nice speed. Now if you really want to understand whether it's moving or not, compare it with this thing, which is hot step 2. This entire section, these two are at the same level. When you start scrolling, you see the hot step 2 is actually moving up, but this Nocta is not moving up at the same pace. It's because I've added it in the reverse direction. So the 0.5 slowing down is letting the Nocta stay slightly behind the other one, right? And that's the effect that I want, essentially this shoe itself. So the shoe is moving up faster than the background Nocta. That's the effect that I wanted, that the default one is working perfectly. Now I'll add the same thing to this section as well, right? Okay, so we go back to edit. Now this section, which is nothing but the text or the content container, I'll click on a scroll animation, click on add, and add another parallax animation, the exact same thing. Let's see if the default values are same. Yes, 0.5 and 0% to 100%. We'll just keep it exactly the same way. Let's quickly see a preview. Yeah, now you see both of them are together because we've given the exact same effect to this text Nocta as well as this hot step, and the sneaker is on top of them. This is the effect that I wanted. Perfect, perfect, wonderful. And I also see that this header is actually moving away. I don't want it to move away. So we will fix that and we'll make a copy and change the images and we are done. So let's go back to edit site one last time perhaps. because we'll be done with it very soon. So first, I'll select this, which is nothing but the header, right? This header, I will select this header section, and then I'll go back to design, and there we will come back to position. The position type is set to default. When you click open this, and when you hover, there are three options: default, sticky, and pinned. And when you hover on them, it actually shows you what will happen, right? So here, default means it'll just scroll away, default. Sticky is it'll remain, but things will scroll on top of it. Whereas pinned means it will remain sticky, but things will scroll underneath it, which is what we want. So I'm going to make it pinned. And now if I go and save preview quickly to show, yeah, you see the header is sticking at the top, just like, you know, any website header, it sticks because I might want to switch categories or whatever. So I wanted to make it sticky, done. So we go back to edit site, and now we will make copy of this. That's it, we'll make copy of this. I'll just remove this for a while so that you see what is happening. This section one, now when I make a copy, I hit command D, duplicate it. I call it section two, right? All the animations that we've added to section one is getting copied. So I will make a few copies, section two, then I'll make one more copy. I'll call it section three. I'll make one more copy and I'll call it section four. Now, if you want to go and see a preview of this whole thing, you see, yeah, now actually the parallax effect is coming up. When you see multiple of them together, when you just have one of them, you don't really understand what effect is coming. But here, now you see everything. Awesome. So let's quickly go ahead and change the content, and we are done. So here we are in edit section. Section one remains the way it is. The orange sneaker Nocta remains. We go to section two. This is section two. It just crawls essentially. So I'll click on this and I have this option to change image. When I click on this change image, so it just takes me to the same site files which we had opened. And remember, we had uploaded all these. So I'm just going to click shoot two, and then I'll click update. So it is going to update this for section two with the new image of the shoe. So there we have it. And now if I go to the other one, section three, here also, I will do the same thing. I'll go to change image and pick the third sneaker, which is this one. Now we have all the images in place, and the last step is to go ahead and change all this text, which is nothing but, you know, you go and type whatever you want, you know, it's your world. I'm just going to make this one Sapta, and it's of course going to remain behind, and just add whichever price, whichever name description that you want, and you are done. You can just have a look at the preview of how beautiful this looks, which you haven't just designed but also developed. Now, of course, you can just go ahead and click on this publish button to make it a live site. Now, I'll not do it because it's not a real website, but you can. And all that you need to do is just click on this publish big blue button on the top right. And we have our website ready. And that's how it's done. Designers, just because you don't know coding doesn't mean you can't make a website. Now, if someone comes to you with their big brand deals and offers to set up your website, you can show off everything you learned from this video. Hit the like button if this video was helpful. Comment below what kind of website you want to make. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button. This is Sapta. I'll see you soon in the next one.